And of course, we're very blessed to have many members of our community and friends of our community who are playing and have played and are continuing to play a prominent role in the activities of Medinat Yisrael. Of course, tonight is not yet Yom Ha'atzmaut, for those who are confused. That is coming on Wednesday night this week, but now it is Rosh Chodesh, and it's Rosh Chodesh of the month of Iyar, and Yom Ha'atzmaut is just a few short days away, and we thought that tonight would be a wonderful opportunity to celebrate together and to hear from some wonderful friends of the community, former members of the community with ties run very, very deep to our Kehila. And we are truly honored to have the pleasure of Daniel Taub joining us to address us first. Obviously, Daniel needs no introduction more from me. He was the ambassador to the court of St. James, a friend of many in the community. And he is going to begin by sharing some stories of Israeli diplomacy, his connection to the English, his time in the UK community, and of course, of his activities in Medinat Yisrael. It's my pleasure to hand over to Daniel Taub.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Sam. What a pleasure to be with you. What a pleasure to be at an event that starts with a Jewish world record of a Jewish event that begins only 3 minutes late. I don't think anything like that has happened in the annals of Jewish history. And I'm only just a little bit insulted not to be invited to speak like the cons as a former member of Dunstan Road Shul. And obviously I had to become a member under the strange regulations of the United Synagogue in order for us to get married, Zahava and me, to get married in the beautiful shul in Dunstan Road. And we have such warm memories, both Zahava's family, my family. We were married by Diane Binstar. We spent wonderful Shabbatot with Rabbi Harvey and so on. So it's a real pleasure to be with you this evening. And I have to say, to see so many faces, I can't call out names, but to see so many warm, familiar faces, it's the closest thing to being at a kiddush that I've experienced for probably a year and a half. So it's really very, very lovely to be with you. And to celebrate Yom Ha'atzmaut. And you know, when thinking about engaging in a conversation with a community like the Dunstan Road, the Golders Green community, where so many of you are so closely connected with Israel, with family in Israel, with children in Israel, spending time in Israel, I was thinking about what I could add to the deep, deep knowledge that you already have and connection to Israel. And so as Sam mentioned, I was thinking that after 25 years in Israel's foreign service, maybe to say a word about why representing Israel is unique amongst representing other countries around the globe, or to ask the question a little bit more Jewishly, why is this diplomat different from all other diplomats? What is unique or different about Israeli diplomacy? And I first got the suspicion that there might be something unique about Israeli diplomacy when I was appointed ambassador and I went to the consular division of the foreign ministry in Jerusalem to get my ambassadorial passport. And I was very proud. I got the diplomatic passport and I opened it up. And inside it said ambassador extraordinary and plenipotentiary, which is what it says in these documents. And I took a look at it. And then I said to the official there, I said, how long have you been issuing these passports? Because I want you to know that you've actually been spelling the word plenipotentiary wrong. And they were very apologetic. They said, give it to us, we'll take it away, we'll change it. And I said, no, I want you to change it from now on, but I want to keep this passport because if ever I get big-headed that I'm an ambassador, I'll remember that I'm representing a country that doesn't know how to spell the word plenipotentiary. And so that's the diplomatic passport that I had with me. But thinking about what really is unique, I think there are a number of reasons. I think I've narrowed it down to about 613. So we'll cancel your plans for the rest of the evening and we'll go. No, seriously, I think I've got it down to about three. And I think the three areas in which there is something that may be a little bit different about representing Israel can sort of be grouped into these categories. First of all, the relationship with the world at large. Secondly, of course, the relationship with the Jewish world, the Jewish communities around the world. And thirdly, the way that the diplomat actually sees him or herself. And so I'd really just like to say a word about those, and then hopefully we'll have a little time for discussion and feedback. So first of all, the way that the world relates to the Israeli diplomat, the first thing that comes to mind is just the extraordinary degree of attention that Israel and Israeli diplomats get. Here you are, you're talking about a country that is the size of Wales, that has a population the same as Togo. And yet, if you look at the international media, if you go to the UN headquarters in New York, or you go to the human rights bodies in Geneva, the degree of attention is absolutely extraordinary. So much so that, you know, newcomers from third world countries are convinced that Israel must be this major superpower. And I'll share with you that Israeli diplomats have slightly mixed feelings about the degree of attention that we get. We're a little bit schizophrenic about it. I remember one time I was at the UN in New York, and I walked in a little bit late to a meeting in the General Assembly, and the Syrian representative was in the middle of this horrendous tirade against Israel. I put on the earphones to hear the translation. It was terrible, and my heart starts sinking. I'm going to have to figure out what he said. I'm going to have to prepare a right of reply and so on. And there was a break in the proceedings, and during the break, I was walking back to the Israeli mission, which is just around the corner. And on the way, I met another Israeli diplomat who was coming back from a different session of the United Nations. And I said to him, how were your debates? How were your sessions this morning? He said to me, oh, they were terrible. Nobody spoke about us at all. So we have this situation where on the one hand, we complain about our attention. On the other hand, we're sort of addicted to our attention and so on. So we have, as I say, a lot of attention. And it cuts both ways. I mean, in some ways, it gives us extraordinary access. You know, when I was in London, it's very unusual that a diplomat representing a country will get to see the foreign secretary, because usually there are undersecretaries that deal with the different ambassadors around the world. But Israel is a special case. And actually, because we're somewhat unique, it was not unusual for me to spend time with the foreign secretary. The first time that I met with William Hague, it was rather funny. I was shown into him. My deputy was supposed to be with me, so he was held up. So I said, please, when he comes along, please show him in. So I was sitting there with William Hague and his team. And then at some point, the door opens and somebody comes in and sits down on the couch next to me. And after a few minutes, it occurs to me that the Foreign Office team, William Hague's team, think he belongs to me, and I think he belongs to them. And so at some point, I just lean over to him and I say, hello, I'm Daniel Taub, I'm the Israeli ambassador. He says, oh, I'm Mahmoud, I'm the new Egyptian ambassador. And he'd just shown up to sign some papers, and they said, oh, we've been waiting for you, go straight on in. But that's part of what it meant, you know, to have that extra degree of access. But obviously it's not just attention, it's attention that tends to be, I think, rather more extreme than the attention that a lot of other countries get, for better and for worse. You know, if you're an ambassador abroad and you come back to Israel on a home visit and you get to meet the prime minister or the foreign minister, they want you to summarize what the situation is for Israel in that country, but they have a busy schedule. So they want you to do it in a very short period of time. So after a little while, I managed to get my summary of what was happening in the UK for Israel down to four words, or at least four words in Hebrew, which I think is quite accurate, actually. And when I was asked the question, I would answer in Hebrew, Hatov mishtaper, v'hara midarder. The good is getting better and the bad is getting worse. And that is a fairly accurate, or certainly it was a fairly accurate situation. I think both halves of that were actually relatively true. First of all, we shouldn't forget that the good really is quite remarkable in the United Kingdom. And we tend to forget the degree and the depth of support, of sympathy, you know, the mailbag that the embassy would receive. You know, sometimes, you know, people would send teddy bears to the Israeli embassy just to encourage us and keep us going, the support from evangelical Christians. The chief of staff I once went to visit had on his desk photos of his family and one other photograph, which was a photograph of this chief of staff, the British chief of staff, with the Israeli chief of staff. It was quite extraordinary. We don't talk about it publicly, but the depth of the the intelligence cooperation, the tech cooperation that was really beginning to take off in the Georgia, the years that I was in the UK and so on. So really something tremendously, tremendously positive. On the other hand, there is another side, which is that there are pockets of hostility to Israel. And you'll find them amongst parts of academia, parts of the media, parts of the trade unions, and a lack of understanding. But one of the things that was very striking to me, that for Israel, that wasn't the main problem. My experience was that overt hostility to Israel, there was a tremendous public spirit that was quite opposed to that. You know, one case that I remember very, very strikingly was the member of parliament for Bradford, who is a guy called George Galloway, decided that he would declare Israel, you know, in Bradford, his constituency, an Israel-free zone. So I said to my staff in the embassy, tomorrow we're all going to Bradford, we're all taking our passports with them. Forget the fact that it's got plenipotentiary spelled wrong. We'll go, we'll wave our passports around, we'll show that we can travel there and so on. And we visited Bradford and we met a lot of people. And one of the things that was so striking to me was that the people of Bradford, many of whom are Muslims, actually were far more opposed to George Galloway than they were to me. They did not want their constituency to be used as a hobby horse for somebody else's, you know, particular campaign and so on. But one of the things that really is very problematic is not so much the overt active boycott as the passive boycott, by which I mean people like universities who don't necessarily have an agenda against Israel, but you'll have a chancellor or a rector who says, it's not worth me getting involved. It's too much aggravation. I don't want to get involved in the politics of this. Or, you know, my team in the embassy would sometimes arrange, you know, for me to go and speak in a university. And the response would be, no, we can't afford the security arrangements that will be necessary in order to have the Israeli ambassador come. So as or whatever and so on. In those cases, I would sometimes say to the chancellor, well, actually, I've looked at your list of trustees. I actually know some of the trustees on your community. They're members of the Jewish community or they're sympathetic to Israel. If you like, I'll have a word with them and see if they can arrange to foot the bill. And immediately somehow the funds would be found before anybody could tell these trustees that the university was having a problem. But I think it is worth remembering it's that passive, unspoken boycott or reluctance that's very difficult. So you have the positive side of the attention, you have the negative side of the attention, and actually sometimes the two go hand in hand in a way that's quite remarkable, and sometimes it's even quite moving. Some of you may remember that there was a very interesting dramatic event that took place in London around the time of the Olympics, which is the Globe Theatre, which I'm sure you all know, the reconstructed Shakespearean theatre on the South Bank, decided to do an Olympiad of Shakespeare's plays, where they approached 36 different countries, they approached the national theatre in each country, and they invited them to perform one of Shakespeare's plays in their own national language in the Globe Theatre. And they approached Israel, they approached Habima, Israel's national theatre company, which was really very moving and you know, very, you know, a cause of pride. And then I heard the play that they had invited Habima to perform, and it was The Merchant of Venice. And my heart just sank, thinking, you know, people think about Jews and the Jewish state is the only association that they have, Shylock and so on. But Habima came over to England to perform it. And then there was a fairly aggressive campaign by boycott activists to try and boycott the theater, to disrupt the presentations. And something like this is a tremendous amount of work on the quiet for diplomats and friends of diplomats and so on. How can we make sure that the theater still puts the show on, and how can we make sure the media covers it correctly and so on and so forth. And so after all of that, Zahava and I went to see the performance. And after all of this fairly exhausting campaign, you know, the thing finally came together with relatively few disruptions, a lot of cooperation, both from the Minister of Culture and from the theater itself. And then we were sitting there watching this play. And I have to say, it was one of the most extraordinarily moving things. Because here we were in this theater, which had been rebuilt from the ashes, watching this play being performed in a language, in Hebrew, which had risen from the ashes. And this play about the Jews had been performed for 400 years without the Jews able to say or do anything about it. And now here we had a national theater that could actually put its own interpretation representing a sovereign state of the Jewish people. And all of a sudden, in a way that I simply hadn't expected, there was something that was very profoundly moving about that particular moment. So those are some thoughts about the first category, the category of the relationship of Israel-Israeli diplomats with the world at large. And now a word about, you know, I suppose the second category, the Jewish world. This is an unusual time of year because if you go to the foreign ministry, there's a lot of nervousness because people are being announced, you know, postings are being announced for the coming year. And I'll let you into a secret that if you want, if you're a young diplomat and you want to be sent to a comfortable Western civilized posting, as opposed to a very difficult, say, third world posting, your chances are best if you are a woman and if you are single. And the reason is, what Jewish foreign ministry would send a young Jewish woman to a country where she is not likely to find a nice Jewish boy to marry? And that is genuinely a consideration in the appointments criteria of the foreign ministry. You know, in the same way that the ministry has to have a mohel on call that can reach any place in the world within 8 days and so on. So in many ways, it's an integrally sort of Jewish foreign ministry. There's also a lot of issues on the agenda of the Israeli diplomat that I think are relatively unique, that are reflective of it. You know, you're not simply advancing commercial interests, political interests of the country, but we have an interest in Holocaust remembrance. We have an interest in fighting anti-Semitism. I have to say some of the most, I would say one of the greatest privileges that I had as a diplomat was to represent Yad Vashem in awarding medals, recognition of righteous amongst the nations for British people who had saved Jews during the Holocaust, including an extraordinary event that was recognizing a group of British soldiers who were interned by the Germans, by the Nazis, and hid a Jewish girl actually inside their detention camp under the eyes of the Nazis. Extraordinary heroism. But those are things that actually are part of the in-tray, if you like, of the Israeli diplomat. But it's not just an agenda. In a sense, it's also an opportunity. I think that Israeli diplomats are tremendously lucky in that we have, if you like, additional tools in the toolbox. I remember one time when I was in London, I was quite friendly with the Greek ambassador and Hanukkah was coming up. So I said to him, you know, we have this festival coming up and it's really about the interaction between ancient Jewish civilization and ancient Greek civilization. I rounded the corners a little bit. I said, wouldn't it be wonderful if we got the leaders of the Greek community together with the leaders of the Israeli and Jewish communities and a bunch of historians to discuss what was going on at the time in ancient Greece and so on and so forth. And it was just a wonderful event. We had Greek food, we had Israeli food and so on, but it just opened the doors to reaching out to all sorts of communities. We did the same thing with the Spanish community, with David Broza, who's sort of half Spanish. We did joint fast breaking on Iftar and Asara B'Tevet and so on and so forth. And it's you suddenly realize that in a sense we're heir to extraordinary diplomatic assets. I mean, one year, the person in the embassy who was responsible for the Christian community came to tell me that the synod was considering passing a boycott resolution. So I said, is there a way that I will be able to go to the synod to speak to them about it? And they said, no, the synod is absolutely firm that they will not have political speakers. So I said, well, maybe you could suggest to them that I'll come, but I won't speak about politics. I'd like to talk to them about why reading the Bible in Hebrew is different to reading the Bible in Latin or in English. So I said, oh, if that's the case, then they'll probably have you. And that's the way that I was invited to the synod and was able to reach out to the bishops. And actually, after that, we started a Bible study session for bishops in Westminster Abbey and so on, because here we are speaking this language, which is an extraordinary cultural asset, not just of Israel, but we're the trustees of it, if you like, for the world and so on. Thinking about the Jewish role of the diplomat, I should say a word about the Jewish community, the interesting relationship between the Israeli diplomat and the Jewish community. It's interesting. Diplomats, ambassadors like to complain about their diaspora communities. And I remember one time the Cypriot ambassador was complaining to me. He goes, "You wouldn't believe it. I've got this Cypriot community here in the United Kingdom. Every month they have an event that they're expecting me to show up." And I almost burst out laughing. Every month, once a month, you know, the problem that we have is the Jewish community, in all of its wisdom, has a communal diary. So there are no clashes between events. You know, diplomats dream of a clash, because then at least there will be one evening that maybe, you know. On the other hand, there's something incredibly moving, genuinely, to see a community. And I don't know if people in the United Kingdom realize how much chesed is involved in the Jewish community in the United Kingdom. I don't know if there is another community where literally night after night you have events and dinners, and sometimes you see the same people who are there because of their commitment to important causes, both causes for Israel and for the Jewish community. And it's a community with a deep connection with Israel. It's a different type of connection to the connection in many other countries. It's not, from my experience, a community that particularly likes raising its head above the parapet, going out to demonstrate, writing angry letters, but it has a relationship that is, you know, in a way deeper than that. I think about the conflict in Gaza in Tzuk Eitan, which took place during the summer. There were 1,200 teenagers who were signed up to be on Israel programs that summer. And all but two of them went to participate in those programs. And that, to me, was an extremely powerful expression of the commitment of the community of families to Israel. I found it, you know, very, 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 very powerful and very moving. Although I have to say, and I'll say it in parenthesis because this is an evening of celebration, but I think as a community, there is a question that needs to be asked about whether the depth of that connection is properly being nurtured and is going to pass on to the next generation. The degree of knowledge and connection to Israel, I think, is a tremendous challenge and something that the community needs to take on board as one of its, you know, something that's high on its communal agenda. I want to leave a little time for discussion, so I'll just say a word or two about category number three, the way the diplomat sees themselves. And, you know, every ambassador, every diplomat, there's something symbolic about the role of being a diplomat. In a sense, becoming an ambassador is a little confusing. You're moving from doing to being. You're representing something. But for a representative of Israel, I think it's even more complicated, because you're not really representing one country, you're actually representing two countries. You're representing the Israel that is a geopolitical entity, a state in the Middle East, but you're also representing an Israel that lives within people's hearts, that is some kind of ideal, almost spiritual home. And if you're a diplomat, you know, it's surprising. You know, I would find hard-headed businessmen come to my office and confide in me like I was the Kotel, like I was the Western Wall, because in a way I was the representative of something that was very intimate to them. Or you would go to a school and kids were Jewish school and kids would be waving flags and singing as you come in, and it plays with your head a little bit, because, you know, they're not doing it for you. They're doing it because you are the way that they can express this particular appreciation for their connection with Israel. But I think there's something that even runs a little bit deeper. One time I was, a British diplomat in Israel came to pay his respects to me before he left to go back to the UK. And this was many years ago. And he said to me, "You know, I'm very jealous of you Israeli diplomats. And I said, why is that? And he said, it's because you truly believe you're part of a mission. And obviously every diplomat feels they're a mission advancing the interests of their country. But I think he picked up on something, which is that for many Israeli diplomats, it runs even a little bit deeper than that. I mean, and you feel it obviously when you're in the Israeli Foreign Ministry in Jerusalem and you're standing next to the wall that has the names of all of the fallen diplomats who have fallen in the course of their duty. But you feel it when you are in the room where the Balfour Declaration was signed, or where you're living as you do in Regent's Park in a house where Weizmann used to come to visit. And you feel it, you know, on so many occasions. Just to finish with maybe one moment that sticks in my mind is the moment when Zahava and I presented our credentials to the Queen. And she asked me, how does it feel to represent your country in the country in which you were born? Which of course is a very good question. And so I said to her, I feel very privileged that it's fallen to me to raise my children in their historic homeland after an exile of 2,000 years. But I'm also very well aware that in the arc of my family's history, during that 2,000 years of exile, the period of greatest hope and opportunity was the period that my family were here in the United Kingdom. And I want to try and express my appreciation by deepening the relations between the countries. And we had a genuinely interesting and thoughtful conversation. And then we left, you know, the Queen, and we stepped outside. And there is a book in which you sign your names. And so Zahava and I signed our names. And then we stepped away from the book and we realized that we'd made a mistake because we signed our names in English. And then we thought, no, we should have signed our names in Hebrew because that is the language that's come back to life in Israel. So we said, is it okay if we could go back? And then they realized these are troublemaking Israelis. Okay, so they let us go back. And we signed our names in Hebrew, and you're standing there in front of this book and you see these flags and you see the Israeli flag flying there next to the Union Jack at the same height and with the same dignity. And you suddenly realize that we are living, for all of the difficulties, in a reality which is greater than anything that our grandparents or our great grandparents could conceive of. So it's an extraordinary privilege to represent it. And probably even more than that, it's an extraordinary privilege to be able to live it. Thank you very much.
Daniel, thank you so much for that beautiful talk, and especially for that last, especially in light of the news about the royal family of the weekend. I think it's a topic that's in everyone's mind, and that interaction and that anecdote for me was a very powerful one. And thank you for sharing.
Sam, I'm going to have to ask you to speak up a little bit. I don't know.
If I'm so sorry. My volume's still not clear. Apologies. Thank you. Can everyone else hear me clearly now? Just a thumbs up if I'm speaking clearly. Excellent. Thank you so much for flagging that, Daniel. We asked you to select a song that really summed up a memory of Israel, and you selected a beautiful one with Kul Olam. I wonder if I can ask you to explain, why did you pick this particular track? And then I'll play it for everyone as we transition.
Okay, sure. I don't know if you're playing it with the video or you're just playing it with the soundtrack.
I can do either. Would you like me to play the video?
My suggestion would be, if you can play it with the video, I'll just say a word.
I will be a pleasure to. So maybe if you explain it, then I'll put the video on for everyone.
A fairly recent sort of development in Israeli, nightlife, if you like, or entertainment, where very large numbers of people, literally thousands of people, will come together from all walks of life, religious, secular, old, young, and they will learn to sing a song together. And they'll be split up into groups and they'll learn the different harmonies, and then they'll all come back together. And you feel the whole of Israeli society together. And a couple of years ago, this was done specifically for Yom Ha'atzmaut, with a wonderful song that I think is as poignant now as it was whenever it was written by Naomi Shemer, which is Al Advash V'Al Ha'oketz, which is about the honey and the bee sting, about celebrating the joy of the good stuff and the bad stuff, of the hardships and the pleasures. And the main melody here is sung by an Israeli old-time singer, Shlomi Shabbat, who actually on this Yom Ha'atzmaut is going to be lighting one of the torches for Yom Ha'atzmaut. If you pay attention very carefully, if you show the video, you'll see Ruby Rivlin, the president, singing along with everybody else. And to me, particularly, to remember the days before Corona, when everybody could crowd together in the stadium and sing, to me, it's a very moving thing. So I'll watch it with you and apologize if I'm going to have to sign off immediately afterwards. So let me wish you all Chag Atzmaut Sameach.
Daniel, thank you so much for your amazing and interesting talk. And now we're all going to together listen to Kul Olam with Shlomi Shabbat.
Shmori al kolele
My heart's beating faster listening to that. I actually had the opportunity to take part in a Kul Olam a couple of years ago when I was in Israel, and the atmosphere brings me right back to singing together, and it's beautiful to be part of that just now. Thank you so much, Daniel. Really appreciate it. Joining us.
Bye-bye.
Lovely to have you with us this evening. Wish you and your family Yom Ha'atzmaut Sameach, and sending love from us all. Thank you.
Love to Hadassah.
And it's now... my honour and privilege to hand over to the second part of this evening, where we are fortunate to have a very, very special interview taking place. And it's my honour to now hand over to Jackie Crossley.
Thank you.
In conversation with the Cohn family.
Let's have the Cohn family. I can't see anybody.
Let me ask to unmute. There they are, the Cohn family there.
Are they here now?
There they are there, exactly.
Are they?
I'll
spot that for everyone. All right, that's better. Hello, hiya. And
Mazel Tov. Thank you.
Yes, because I don't know if everybody knows, Yisrael and Hannah have just had an engagement for their eldest daughter, and they've just come from a bat mitzvah of a niece, so it's been quite a week. It's lovely, lovely. Hello, both of you.
Hello. It's so lovely to see you.
Lovely to see you both as well. Very lovely to see you both. Do I need to introduce you? Yisrael is the son of Ruth and Moshe Cohn, and you probably see Ruth's Mr. and Mrs. every month. We get a nice letter from Ruth all about what you're up to in Jerusalem. But I'd like to start with both of you, because Hannah, you started life in Liverpool, and Yisrael, I believe, in Golders Green, or for most of it anyway. So perhaps you'd like to introduce yourselves a bit and say how you felt about living where you did and leaving to come, you know, what made you want to make Aliyah?
So I was born in Liverpool, as Jackie mentioned, and I studied in the Jewish school in the King David, and I lived there till I was 18. Then I went to a year in Israel, and after Israel, I moved to London, and then we made Aliyah after our first year of marriage in London. Growing up in Liverpool, for me, was an amazing experience, because if you wanted to have something done in the Jewish community, you had to do it. So all the teenage boys learned to lane in order to run the youth minyan. If you wanted the school to do something, you had to do it. So we felt the need to participate in the community, and we gained great skills and a sense of community from that.
I grew up in Dunstan Road. I grew up in Golders Green, which was a beautiful community. I have many fond memories of growing up in Golders Green. Went to Dunstan Road when it was the big shul, and there was an upstairs as well, which was a long time ago. It's lovely even now, looking at the Zoom and seeing so many faces that we recognize from the time that we were there. Even though we've been in Israel for now over 20 years, still very much connected. The place where you grew up is very much part of your identity. And I grew up in Dunson Road. And then when I was in college, I was in London. Hannah was also there. We met in college. We got married in London. And then, thank God, we came on Aliyah. And now we live in Jerusalem.
No, you lived in London when you got married. You got married in Liverpool, because I went. I was there.
We got married in Liverpool. Our offer was in Dunston Road. And our first year of married life was spent in Dunston Road, in Golders Green.
That's right.
And we have really happy memories of that foundation year in London before we made Aliyah. And it was so special, davening in a shul where there was old and young and more religious and less religious. And that sense of community was something we took to Israel with us. The idea that you can live amongst all different people and you can find connections and you can find a community, even with people who possibly you might not think you're a natural ally. And that was the foundation that Dunston Road gave us before we made Aliyah.
That's nice to hear. And I think, Yisrael, you were our youth minister, our youth officer at one time.
Yes. Well, I saw, after I came back from yeshiva, I was in yeshiva for 2 years. And then when I came back from yeshiva, I was studying in London. And we used to daven, I don't know if it's still there, in the Lebekin Hall. Is that gone now?
Yeah, it's gone now, I'm afraid.
Oh, wow. The Alav HaShalom, we were in the Lebekin Hall, and every week we used to go into the main shul and see if we could, at the beginning, we didn't always have a minyan. There were like 6 or 7 of us. We go into the main shul, and then everybody would try and hide, because we try and rope in 3 or 4 men to help us get the minyan to start off at the beginning of the service each week. But really, it took off, and then when we got married, we continued in that role, serving the community, and it was a very exciting time.
Mm-hmm. And I remember when you made Aliyah, you didn't go straight to Jerusalem, did you? I remember where you started, because I came and stayed there once with you. You can tell everybody.
When we first made Aliyah, we were house parents just outside Efrat in Gush Etzion. We were house parents in a boys' yeshiva in Yeshivat HaMifta. And we lived in these, what they're called, caravillas, these caravans. And Jackie was brave enough to come and stay with us for Shabbat, I think. But it was a lovely way to enter Israel. It was a community of young marrieds. The doors were always open. Again, a sense of family when your family wasn't, you know, near you. It was a lovely place. It was a gentle landing, as they say.
Yeah, I remember I was lucky because Ruth and Moshe stayed with you, but there wasn't room for me in the same caravan. So I had my own at the end, and it was right by the fence and all these soldiers going up and down and guarding. And I thought, well, either I wait all night and just if I die, I die anyway, or do I sleep and not worry? And I went to sleep and didn't worry, and I was fine. And the next morning,
there
it was all
you
right.
Go.
As amazing you can see.
Our amazing soldiers were looking after us.
I remember that time as well. And then you went to Jerusalem and you've made a life there now. And I've got a list of what you're doing, but you're here to tell us, not for me to tell you. So you can tell us what you're doing there now, please.
So after those few years in Gush Etzion, we moved to Jerusalem. We live in Katamon, and we're very blessed. We live a 10-minute walk from Yisrael's parents, and 3 years ago, my parents also made Aliyah, and they also live a 10-minute walk. So we're very blessed to live near both our sets of parents. I run the Israel branch of the Gift Charity, which started in England, where we encourage people to volunteer and to do acts of giving. We have a big project this week in schools in Israel, writing thank you letters to soldiers. So I run the Gift Israel branch, and Yisrael.
I work for the Jerusalem municipality. It's an incredible thing, actually, that the Jerusalem municipality has a department that assists communities around the world find out about Jerusalem prior to Aliyah. So if there's a family that wants to make Aliyah and they want to find the right school for their kids or find employment or choose a neighborhood, we're in contact with communities around the world to tell them about life in Jerusalem so that when they arrive, they're all set for their life in Jerusalem, which is...
It's a free service and we're all waiting for your applications and your inquiries for anybody who wants details.
You might be getting me, you never know.
That would be amazing.
That the answer to your father's prayers.
They say that you only have one regret when you make Aliyah, and that is you deny your children the joy of making Aliyah. We made Aliyah, and it was such an amazing experience to choose to come to Israel, but Baruch Hashem, our children were all born here, so, and they never had this experience of making Aliyah, but they gain in other ways. But yes, it's a great experience to those.
Well, Baruch Hashem, you've got a big family and come from it. The whole Cohn family have got lots of children, haven't they? So between you, you've done very well. It's marvellous. Kanei Nahara, it's lovely. Absolutely lovely. And everybody's nearby. Yeah. Now, does anybody, I don't know if people are going to want to ask anything. I will hand over to Rabbi Sam. He's going to organise, because we've got your piece of music. You can explain. You've chosen a piece of music. Perhaps you'd like to talk about it before.
So when we were asked to choose a piece of music, it caused quite a debate. Baruch Hashem, Yisrael and I agree on many, many things, but our taste of music isn't always the same. So we had quite a debate about what song we should pick. And then we chose a piece from Hallel. Tonight, tomorrow is Rosh Chodesh. And it's a piece we're gonna, a piece we're gonna sing in Hallel. And the idea is just gratitude to Hashem that Baruch Hashem, we live in Israel, we're surrounded by family, we're blessed with great children. And it's just, we're back in our homeland, we're back in Israel. I remember when my grandfather once came to visit us in Israel, he was in his 80s and our oldest son Uriel was taking the school bus to go to school in the old city. And he was just amazed that his great grandchild was going to school in the old city, learning in Hebrew, a flourishing modern language. And he just thought that was just miraculous. So we feel this gratitude to Hashem that we're able to live in Israel, surrounded by family in peaceful times. And Israel is a world leader in so many ways, technology and medical rescue. We just feel so blessed to live here. So on that, we agreed. And it's a piece by Mordechai Ben David, MBD, and it's a song where our kids also love it, and we often sing it on Rosh Chodesh and many other times as well.
Enjoy Rosh Chodesh. Enjoy it all.